Today's video about four, we're going to talk about amplitude modulation, frequency modulation, and syncing. These are three different ways to manipulate an oscillator by its core. But the trend here is that they always need a different oscillator to make it work, because one oscillator is actually modulating the other one. And this is where things may get a little bit tricky. But understanding like what a oscillator is doing, then at some extent you're going to understand the relationship, like, okay, I have this oscillator, I'm going to use that oscillator to modulate the other oscillator, I'm going to get that as a result. This may take some time to get there, to eventually go like, okay, that's how we do it. But that goes with trial and error stuff. I mean, that's usually the case. The easiest way to understand everything about syncing, AM, and frequency modulation is using sine waves, because it makes you understand better that way, like what's really happening with the sound. Because a sine wave is always going to be a repeating pattern. It always goes like that. It always goes like that. Goes on and off in a kind of like a sine wave. But in theory, you have a thing that's called AM. And what AM stands for is amplitude modulation, which changes the volume of an oscillator. In this particular case, if I use it like this, the only thing that I'm doing is turning on and off the oscillator manually. But what if? We're going to use a secondary oscillator right here, take a sine wave, and we're going to use that second sine wave, which sounds like that, but I'm going to turn that thing with one octave, which sounds like this. But this oscillator is going to be used with an AM amount towards the first oscillator. That sounds like this. And in theory, what will happen is that this oscillator will now turn on and off the volume of that oscillator right there, depending on, determined by the speed of this oscillator. Because at some extent, if I do it like this, I get a whole different contour. Do it like that, I get a whole different contour. Turn the pitch one up, I get something like this going on. At some extent, it feels almost like I'm playing two different sine waves at the same time, which I'm not doing, because as you can see right here, oscillator 2 is not audible. It's not going through the filter at all. Even better yet, I can just bypass the filter because I'm not using it at all. But the only thing that's going to be used over here is oscillator 1, as you can see right there. But because I'm using amplitude modulation in this particular context, I'm making you believe that I'm actually using a secondary oscillator. While I'm not doing in theory, I'm using that for a amplitude modulation source. Even better yet, if I'm going to use a saw wave, it almost sounds like I'm using a saw wave on top of this sine wave. But I'm not doing that. The only thing that I'm doing is that I'm turning on and off the sine wave, determined by this saw wave right here. And because that's actually happening in that rapid state, it almost makes you feel and believe like I'm actually mixing those two together. But in theory, I'm not doing that, because I'm turning on and off the volume really, really fast. Even better yet, it will be kind of like similar. If you're not familiar with the modulation bus matrix, don't worry, we'll get back to that one. But it kind of would be similar as doing it like this. We'll set up the drive like here. We'll turn off this oscillator with the amplitude modulation amount right there. This is going to be an exaggerated example, by the way. I'm going to enable the filter. That's what I'm doing in theory. The major difference between using an LFO compared with a normal oscillator is that a normal oscillator is audible by the human ear. It plays certain pitches which are recognizable, while the LFO in this particular case stands for a low frequency oscillator, which triggers a oscillator frequency which is that low that you cannot hear them normally by the human ear. That's one of the reasons why it turns on and off the volume really slow. But in theory, I'm doing the exact same thing using an analog oscillator in this particular context. Um, as you can hear right there. But the cool thing is, there is a thing that's called AM to oscillator to amount, which means that I can also determine like how much of those changes am I going to apply to it using this switch right here. So in this case, I can enable that effect, and I can disable that effect. Enable that effect and disable that effect. Easy for manipulating, let's say, a baseline where you have something moving up and downwards, but then like with a pattern, kind of like with a pattern. This kind of brings me to frequency modulation, because frequency modulation is something totally differently compared to amplitude modulation as well. Because amplitude modulation is about changing the volume, while frequency modulation is about changing the pitch. In theory, what I could do is say I have oscillator 2 over here. I can set an amount. I'm going to go for 66 in this case, because 66 in this context is 1 octave. And I'm going to connect this thing to the pitch of oscillator 1. It sounds like this. If I change the oscillator 2 over here, right there. What will happen in theory is that the pitch of this oscillator will determine the pitch of that oscillator in a rapid state. It kind of depends like what the pitch is doing on the second oscillator in this particular context. In theory, what this is that this is the modulator, while this is the receiving end, and that is also known as the carrier. So what I'm doing in theory is creating a two operator FM synth. But while in theory using the pitch is not all deal, there is also something that's called oscillator 1 frequency modulation amount, which does something similar, but the frequency ranges are differently compared to just setting that whole thing with pitch. As you can see right here, if I set this thing to 66 again, trigger the same note, I get a whole different sound coming from this whole thing. Even better yet, to get a similar sound from this whole sound that I just created, I need to go much lower in this particular context. Right there. So at some extent you could see that setting up the frequency modulation amount using this setting right here also results into higher pitch changes, effects, frequencies that are taking place, because in this case I can also turn this into noise if I want to. While using the pitch in particular in this context, it doesn't even get there, even while the maximum value is set to 100. Same value, different setting. But in theory, these are basically based on frequency modulation that are taking place. The character is differently compared to the other one. That's the most fundamental bit. In theory, what I could also do is say I have oscillator 2, I'm going to connect this thing to the frequency modulation amount of oscillator 1. It sounds like that. But then I'm going to scale it down with a setting that's called a low frequency oscillator, which means that this LFO will now determine the amount of frequency modulation that is going to be applied to it. So at some extent I can also drop the rate, I can drop the amount. Speed things up. While still using two different sine waves. The character from this whole sound already starts to sound totally differently to the original sound that I already had. That is frequency modulation. And frequency modulation is often used in, let's say, old school 8-bit synthesizer modules, like the Sega Genesis had this, the OPL 2 had this, the OPL 4 had this, stuff like this. Based on different FM operators. If you take more of the complex methods on frequency modulation, you have a 6 operator FM synth. The DX7 comes in mind from Yamaha, which is a really popular synth to use. There is a VST version of this that is the DX'd, which is a VST. And then there is the PX7, which is a rack extension format, which I'll just show you this over here. That's this one right here. based on 6 different operators, all based on sine waveforms. And what you're basically doing is using 6 different operators in pair, where you can decide like which oscillator is modulating the other oscillator, and that results into an output, and that modulates something else, and that results into a whole new sound. The more operators that you're going to have, the more complicated the FM synth may work. This is also one reason why, for instance, a 2-pair FM synth is much more easier to understand rather than comparing that with a 6-operator FM synth. I might also note that the amount of timbre is also going to vary from a 6-operator FM synth versus a 2-pair operator FM synth, because you're basically limiting yourself with 2 operators. That's a sidetrack. Then we come to another fundamental piece of manipulating a waveform by score, and that's sync. And sync is a little bit harder to explain, and I hope I can actually do this right, because syncing is a method where you basically sync one waveform with another waveform when one is the master and the other one is the slave. And what will happen in theory is that the master basically tells to the slave, like, okay, you know what, I'm going to tell you when you're going to reset. That's what the master does. And the slave just sits there and listens in to the master and basically listens in, like, when do I need to reset my waveform? And the only way that you're going to make sync work is by having 2 different pitches, because that's the most essential part with syncing. You have to have 2 different pitches from one oscillator to another. So the pitch from the master will be varying from the pitch of the slave. And I'm not talking about tuning, I'm talking about semi-notes, either the octaves. Otherwise it will not work. At least you're not going to hear the audible differences, let me put it that way. To show you this on the fly, I'm going to turn on sync of this one. And what will happen in theory is this, is that the master in this case is oscillator 1. And the slave in this case is going to be oscillator 2, which means in theory is that the master over here will not change at all. It does not listen in to like who is syncing what, because it's the master oscillator. So if I play this oscillator, let's get rid of this. If I play this oscillator, it basically plays like a straightforward sine wave. The slave, however, is going to be manipulated, because it listens in like what the master is doing, and because the pitch is higher, that also means that the reset factor is going to be more often compared to like what the original oscillator was doing. So if I listen to it like this, it almost sounds like I'm triggering a saw wave. Well, it's not in theory. It's still a sine waveform, but while this thing is doing its cycle over here, at this point, this master basically says something like, you know what, I have done my cycle, all my slaves need to reset itself. And this is one of the reasons why this behavior is taking place, because this is going to be the starting point, and then it just does its thing, and this is the point where the master basically tells to the slave, you're going to reset yourself. This is one of the reasons why this behavior is taking place. But if I do it the exact opposite way, like this, take the oscillator octave to lower, I get this going on. There is barely any resetting taking place, because at some extent this oscillator is going to be 2 times slower compared to the slave, what the slave is doing. So at some extent it could still do its thing, but at this point there's a little bit like a fraction taking place where the other oscillator has done its thing, which is basically based on 2 cycles. As you can see right here, that's 1 cycle, that's the second cycle, reset, because we're 1 octave lower. Then this is the first cycle, this is the second cycle, then it resets itself because it's 1 octave lower. So at some extent you could use pitches from octave settings to make changes within the slave oscillator by resetting itself, and that turns into a new type of sound. So if I go 1 octave higher, like here, that's the original, look like that, that's a sine wave, or that's a saw wave, but go 1 octave higher, get this going on. Go 1 octave higher, I got this going on. So at some extent it feels like I'm changing the pitch, but the cool thing is I'm not, because what I'm doing is I'm keeping the pitch, but I'm resetting the oscillator faster. And that compared with this, there. It basically sounds quite similar, but there are different harmonics taking place that makes you believe like it's higher pitched, whilst not in theory. That's the major difference there. Where syncing kind of gets cool is if you're going to do something like this. You have a modulation envelope and you're going to change the pitch of, let's say, the slave while doing so, which also adds an additional probability where the resetting factor actually takes place. So in this case, I'm going to go for modulation envelope right there. I'm going to set an amount. I'm going to connect this thing to the oscillator pitch, which will reset and result into. Kind of like a morphing sound, all based on sine waves. But the only thing that's going to change is the moment when the sine wave resets itself, based on the master. At some extent, I could do the same thing by doing the exact opposite, by saying I'm going to keep the slave as is, but in this case, I'm going to change the pitch of the master, which results into a whole different side effect, because in this case, the pitch change or the resetting factors are going to change. That kind of makes you believe like I'm actually changing the pitch. While in theory, I'm not, because I'm resetting the waveform. Just like that. So yeah, that's a little bit about syncing, AM and frequency modulation. In the next episode, I will talk more a little bit about envelopes in general. Have lots of fun, and I will talk to you later.